Harper Audio presents Pacific. Silicon chips and surfboards, coral reefs and atom bombs, brutal dictators, fading empires, and the coming collision of the world's superpowers. By Simon Winchester. This is the author. For Setsko. Look east where whole new thousands are. Robert Browning from Waring. Prologue. The lonely sea and the sky. Here from this mountain shore, headland beyond stormy headland, plunging like dolphins through the blue sea smoke into pale sea, look west at the hill of water. It is half the planet, arched over to Asia, Australia, and White Antarctica. Those are the eyelids that never close. This is the staring, unsleeping eye of the earth, and what it watches is not our wars. Robinson Jeffers from The Eye, 1965. United Airlines Flight 154 leaves Honolulu International Airport just after dawn, three times a week, bound ultimately for the city of Hagatna, the capital of the island republic of Guam. If the northeast trades are blowing at their usual steady 12 knots, the jet will take off to the east into the low morning sun over Waikiki, and those passengers on the aircraft's left side will see the wall of skyscraper hotels along the beachfront and be able to glimpse down at Doris Duke's great seaside mansion, Shangri-La. Once the plane is 2 miles high above the crater of the dormant Diamond Head volcano, it'll begin to make a long and lazy turn to the right. If the morning haze is light, passengers on the right side now can sometimes glimpse the bombers and heavy transport planes lined up on the flight line of Hickam Field, and maybe a flotilla of sleek grey warships will be gliding slowly through the locks of Pearl Harbor. There will be some suburbs clustered between the shore and the slopes. There'll be a skein of rush hour traffic crawling along on H1, the main throughway into Honolulu, and behind these urban images will rise ranges of mountains, razor-sharp aiguille, dotted in places with white radar domes. With every one of its seats invariably filled, the plane will then clear its throat and tilt its nose ever higher, and once at 5 miles high, it'll set its autopilot to a southwesterly course, heading out initially over 2,000 miles of clear, blue, unpeopled ocean. And as the climb flattens out and the aircraft passes through a final stratum of small puffballs of cloud, in a blink the island behind fades, is suddenly gone from view, and all below is just sea, endless, empty sea, with many hours of emptiness ahead. The ocean beneath is almost unimaginably vast and illimitably various. It is the oldest of the world's seas, the relic of the once all-encompassing Pan-Thalassic Ocean that opened up 750 million years ago. It's by far the world's biggest body of water. All the continents could be contained within its borders, and there'd be ample room to spare. It's the most biologically diverse, the most seismically active. It sports the planet's greatest mountains and deepest trenches. Its chemistry influences the world, and the planetary weather systems are born within its boundaries. Most see this great body of sea only in parts, a beach here, an atoll there, a long expanse of deep water in between. Just a few, mariners mostly, have the good fortune to confront the ocean in its entirety, and by doing so to win some understanding of the immense spectrum of happenings and behaviours and people and geographies and biologies that are to be found within and on the fringes of its 64 million square miles. For those who do, the experience can be profoundly humbling. Captain Cook wrote that by exploring the Pacific he had gone as far as I think it possible for man to go. To traverse it today, 2.5 centuries later, to set a course from Kamchatka to Cape Horn, to pass between the Aleutians and Australia, to make a 10,000-mile crossing from Panama to Palawan, is to experience a sense of the frontier that is lacking almost everywhere else on the planet. And not simply for its immensity, but also for the pervasive sense, even today, of confrontation with the unknown and the unknowable. The British Admiralty's revered chart room Bible, Ocean Passages for the World, still cautions sailors embarking on a crossing. Very large areas, it says, of the Pacific Ocean are unsurveyed, or imperfectly so. In many areas, no sounding at all has been recorded. The only safeguards are a good lookout and careful sounding. United 154 operated most days by one of the more battered old planes from United's Hawaiian stable is known locally as the Island Hopper, makes its journey along almost 6,000 miles, and it takes some 14 shuddering hours to do so. It skitters southwestward, then westward, then northward, stopping along the way at five places, all of them islands scattered among three different countries that are even less familiar to most than is Guam's one city of Hagatna. UA-154's first stops of half an hour or so are on the flat atolls of Majuro and Kwajalein in the Republic of the Marshall Islands. It then does the same at runways that have been squeezed into the more dramatically mountainous and jungle-draped topographies of the islands of Kosrae, Pohnpei and Chuuk in the Federated States of Micronesia. A scant few passengers travel all the way to Guam. There's much getting off and getting on, and luggage of daunting sizes and bewildering shapes is brought on and taken off at each stop. The crew members, leather-skinned old-timers who have some passing acquaintance with the local island languages, are obliged by United to make the entire journey. They'll have recited their seatbelt and tray table hymns no fewer than 12 times before the final touchdown, and seem almost comatose with relief on their arrival in Guam. In the popular European imagination, the Pacific Ocean contains many of the elements that are to be found along that 6,000-mile passage between Honolulu and Hagatna. In every stopping place, it is invariably warm and tropical. Both the sea and the sky are intensely blue, the air is sweetly breezy, and there are white sands and coral reefs and sparkling fish of vivid colours darting between the anemone fronds. The roads are decked with bougainvillea and flamboyance and orchids and parrots, with papaya trees and palms of incredible profligacy that drip with dates and bananas and coconuts. Palm trees are central to Pacific imagery. They're to be seen leaning slightly off the vertical under the endless press of the trade winds, and thereby offering a picture-perfect and theatrically green backdrop for every beach scene. A frame for other equally familiar images of curling waves and spume, or as a border to an empty ocean panorama with its distant gatherings of surfers waiting patiently for the rollers to break and the seas to begin to run. Such is in evidence everywhere, at every stop on the United Island Hopper's run. Hawaii, the starting point, is of course the quintessential exemplar of the mixing of what outsiders see as Polynesian magic and trans-Pacific migration. From Polynesia, there's the plangent sound of the ukulele, the sight of the grass skirt, the blossom in thick black hair tipped behind the ear, the nut-brown skin, the dancing, the dancing, the dancing. Yet, when I lived for a while in Manoa, on the eastern side of Honolulu City, it was not so much Polynesian culture that lapped into every corner of my life as the cultural influences of the farther side of the Pacific Ocean. There was a Japanese grocery store down the street, a Burmese restaurant next door, and every other person on the bus seemed to be from Manila. I kept hearing Korean spoken in the elevators and met Chinese migrants in the most unexpected places. The elderly man who cut what remains of my hair was from Kowloon and had been a waiter for decades on the Coral Princess, a Hong Kong-flagged liner that once shuttled between Sydney and Tokyo by way of Jakarta, Port Moresby, Manila and Shanghai. Statistics bear out the easily forgotten reality that whites, hauli in the vernacular, a word uttered with some disdain, are a minority on the Hawaiian Islands. Their 336,000 in 2010 are matched by almost 500,000 from countries around or within the Pacific Ocean, including 200,000 Filipinos and 185,000 Japanese, 80,000 only are native Hawaiians. Nonetheless, Polynesia rather than Pacific Asia is the current preferred affect of Hawaii. Polynesia is the impression one likes to carry away as the islands fade astern or over the horizon. Hula, luau, aloha, lei, ohana, the best-known words from a lexicon constructed from the 13 letters of the Hawaiian alphabet, hear them and you know in an instant which ocean you're in. This place, though an American state since 1959, the other Pacific state, Alaska, was similarly admitted almost 8 months beforehand, and much changed as a consequence, is still, in its perceived cultural essence, the Pacific of its Western devotees. Hawaii manages still, deep down, to evoke some of what was felt by Gauguin during his time in the Marquesas, or by those who brought Omai Arayatea to London, or by those gently compassionate scholar administrators such as Arthur Grimble, famed for his once favourite memoir of Pacific life, A Pattern of Islands. Hawaii's shopping malls and warplanes and mountaintop telescopes and aircraft carriers and its legions of resident oceanographers and meteorologists may give the impression that the islands have fully entered and embraced the modern era. Yet culturally, Hawaii is still Polynesia, linked firmly to Easter Island and the Cook Islands and Aotearoa, the land of the long white cloud, New Zealand. Hawaii, for all its apparent intimacy with the American mainland, still resonates with the old Pacific stories of Herman Melville, of Robert Louis Stevenson. It is still emotionally connected to the Pacific that so enchanted poets such as Rupert Brooke, who spent 7 idyllic months 2,000 miles farther south in Tahiti and memorialized it in lines that once heard are long remembered. Tau here, mamua, crown the hair and come away. Hear the calling of the moon and the whispering scents that stray about the idle warm lagoon. Hasten, hand in human hand, down the dark, the flowered way, along the whiteness of the sand and in the water's soft caress, wash the mind of foolishness. They may well be, but the Pacific of Brooke's soft caress is soon swallowed up as United 154 soars ever westward each morning into what swiftly becomes much darker territory, both metaphorically and actually. Some 1,500 miles on from Honolulu, the flight crosses the international dateline, and the day on board is instantly transmuted into tomorrow. Wristwatch date windows have to be changed and diary pages flipped forward, the shadows at each airport stop lengthening so the next day's afternoon steadily begins to take over from the past day's morning. The dateline, a necessary evil for maintaining a system of timekeeping in a spheroidal and interconnected world, was originally set down here, right in the middle of the Pacific. It could have arrowed straight from north to south, like an anti-meridian to Greenwich on the opposite side of the globe, but since it was going to make calendric mayhem in whatever populated place it passed through, the delegates to the International Meridian Conference, held in Washington, D.C. in 1884, designed it to zigzag this way and that around the islands and minor republics and kingdoms that got in its way or were near to it. At the time this was done, the Pacific was a commercially comatose expanse of sea, with neither aircraft nor telephone cables in place, its international trade limited mainly to the peddling of copra, whale oil, and guano. The existence of an ephemeral line that magically decreed it to be noon on a non-working Tokyo Saturday, while it was still breakfast time on a potentially busy California Friday, had scarcely any effect on such matters as the trade in guano futures. In the days long before arbitrage became all the rage, the dateline was no more than an idle conceit, something for stewards on long-haul ships to tell their passengers who found gaining a day, or losing a day, to be greatly amusing. Today, however, when snap decisions in Japan can urgently affect financial doings in San Francisco, the line has become something of an inconvenience. A Friday decision can't always be made because where it needs to be made, it's Saturday. It need not have been so. Back in 1884, because of arguments over the sighting of the prime meridian, with the apoplectic French naturally opposed to its running through a suburb of London, a genial Canadian time zone expert named Sandford Fleming suggested that the prime meridian be placed in the middle of the Pacific instead, and the date line made to run from pole to pole where the Greenwich line does today. His idea was ridiculed, but today some few remember him rather fondly and would also like to see the date line moved into the Atlantic, to minimise the nuisance it now causes in this commercially busiest ocean in the world. Yet, this is no more than technical stuff. There's quite another kind of darkness into which United 154 flies, a more metaphorical darkness, and one that helps paint a rather fuller picture of today's Pacific Ocean. Once across the line, the plane leaves the ethnic limits of Polynesia. The Marshall Islands, of which Majuro is the capital, are part of the sprawling archipelagos of Micronesia. Together with the prettily named Carolines and the Marianas, these hundreds of small islands in the northwestern quadrant of the ocean, some of them tall and volcanic, most of the Marshalls low atolls of coral and lethally vulnerable to the ever-rising seas, present en bloc a troubling example of the recent history of the ocean and its people, of what can happen to a place and a population subject to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.